Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to my deadly house of horror, and to the fifth story in my series. It is appropriate that this is story number five, because the number itself appears in the title, and also the title is composed of five words. In the science of numerology, the number five is held to be a magical number, and magic, as you know, can take many forms, sometimes merely entertaining, but sometimes fearful and sinister, as in the world of black magic. My story today is a sinister one indeed, and concerns a beast whose fearful presence defies all normal logic. It is a story that truly takes us into that blacker side of magic, where the number five holds court. Where did this beast come from? From where did it derive its terrible power? Why did it seek such a deadly and desperate revenge? But ladies and gentlemen, allow me, with some trepidation, to present you to the beast who to this very day still haunts the mind of a certain Mr. Saunders, the beast, in fact, with five fingers. On the night in question, Saunders had been out visiting and had arrived back as the nearby church clock tolled 12. He let himself into the house, and as he did so, he heard his employer's voice calling him.
Saunders, is that you?
Yes,
just back. Sorry I'm late.
Saunders, for pity's sake, come in here quickly, in the library.
All right, but well, it's gone 12. I thought you'd be in bed, right? What's all the matter?
Oh, thank God you're back.
You sound awful, Eustace. What the devil's the matter?
Shut the door, for heaven's sake, shut the door.
This isn't like you at all. There's the famous balls over My God, you're white as a sheet. What is it in the name of all that's wonderful? What is it?
Saunders, it's here, in this room, up there, in the little gallery.
What?
You won't believe me. I know you won't. I hardly believe it myself. It's too horrible.
Oh, come on, old boy. I'm known as Gullible Saunders, the man that believes anything.
Don't make a joke of it. Not tonight. I beg you. It's deadly serious.
Well, I don't see anything out of the ordinary. It all looks perfectly calm and peaceful.
I cornered it behind those books, the big shelf there. It's tired, too, I think, for the minute. Won't move for a little. It's been leading me a merry dance all evening, Saunders.
It? What do you mean, it? I mean, for a hard-headed scientist, I must say you're being deuced mysterious.
But think I want to be mysterious. I've got no alternative. If you understood what I know about that thing behind the books.
Look
there.
Here, Eustace, you're either temporarily off your head or there is something behind the books. I'm going to look.
Saunders, don't go near it, not yet. Please, it might...
Might what?
Listen, Saunders, if you sit down, I'll tell you what I know. And look, I'm calmer now, you can see that. I must tell you, before I get you to help me catch it.
Well, whatever you like. What about a drink? Yeah. Whiskey? Brandy? Mm. You look as though you could do with one.
Brandy, please.
Mind if I have one as
well? No, of course not. No soda. Thank you. Now, to begin with, I want you to believe that everything I'm going to tell you is the gospel truth. You remember that the afternoon post came in just before you went off in the car?
Yes, Morton put the letters on your desk unopened.
And there was something else. A box. A little wooden box.
Oh, yes, of course. I'd forgotten that there was some kind of animal in it, a rat or something. I assumed it was the four-toed albino old Terry was sending you for our latest experiments.
Yes, so did I, heaven help me. Do you remember what Morton said when he brought the box in?
Vaguely. Something about the local post office boys boring holes in the lid. That the thing was making a devilish scratching inside, and whoever had packed it had forgotten to make some air holes.
The thing in that box did not need to breathe.
What?
Now look. Do you remember My uncle Adrian Balzo.
Well, I remember he had the decency to die a couple of weeks ago and leave you more money than even you know what to do with.
You met him, I think.
Well, once or twice, only fleetingly. Nice old chap,
didn't he was a nice old chap, as you put it, one of the nicest possible. I used to visit him a lot during his last illness, did what I could to cheer him up. I used to sit with him when he was confined to bed. He was always very grateful. Now listen, very, very carefully. You know that my uncle was completely blind?
Yes.
Well, a few months before his death, he developed the power of automatic writing. He was sitting quite quietly in bed one day reading Braille with his left hand when I suddenly noticed that he had a pencil in his right hand. He had beautiful hands, you know, very long and slender. And the pencil was moving swiftly across the opposite page, writing.
And the old boy didn't know?
No, he was deep in his book. It was quite clear. He had no idea. It was even clearer when I found out later that this automatic writing went on most fluently when he was actually sleeping. He would fall into a doze, and then his right hand would grope about for a pencil and would start writing, just as if it had some kind of life of its own.
That's fascinating. What did it write?
Well, that's the point. Gibberish, absolute gibberish. Complete nonsense. Rambling words and phrases in a strange, ugly script. Quite unlike my uncle's writing.
You're sure he didn't know?
Oh, positive. I tested him, asked him questions when he'd gone on for some time, and it was certain he knew nothing. Nothing at all. And then one day...
Yes?
One day... After this had been going on for some weeks, just before the old boy died, it started to make sense.
What do you mean?
Well, I was watching, almost hypnotized by it, you know, and it was so odd. And suddenly, it was writing my name over and over and over again. Eustace Bolsover, Eustace, 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 with a strange maniac intensity.
What did you do?
I spoke to it.
Spoke to it?
I said very quietly so as not to waken my uncle. I said, "Who are you?"
Well, did it answer?
Oh, yes. Well, not exactly. It wrote down answers with a kind of horrid facetiousness almost. Look, let's see this piece of paper. I took it away before my uncle woke up that day. I filled in my questions in the spaces between the answers it wrote.
Who are you? Never mind. Was it my uncle who was writing? Oh, my prophetic soul, mine uncle. Is it anyone I know? You will see me very soon. When? When poor old Adrian is dead and I'm free. Where shall I see you?
Its answer to that question gave me a stranger thrill than I'd like to admit. Do you see what it said when I asked, "Where shall I see you?"
Where shall you not? It is a bit weird, isn't it?
After you went out, I got a screwdriver and a hammer to open up this box that had come in the post. It was fairly dark. I'd only my old oil lamp on, you know. I hate the glare of electricity. I took the screws and the nails out and put a heavy book on the lid to keep it down while I went to fetch a cage from the lab. Before I was out of the room, I heard a crash. The book had fallen off. The animal was stronger than I thought. It had escaped. I could hear it scuttling up the little iron stairway to the gallery library.
What was it? A rat?
I was going after it when my eye fell on the unopened letters Morton had brought in. For some reason, I felt compelled to open one of them. I don't know why. Read it. It was from old Stoker, the family solicitor. Look at the last paragraph. Starting at a very strange request.
Yes. A very strange request from your late uncle. Just before he died, had a letter from him. Take it, he was very ill and couldn't write easily. The script was rather awkward. Cancelled his previous instructions about his funeral. He wished his body to be embalmed when he died and gave us the address of the man we were to employ with orders saying that his right hand was to be amputated and sent to you, stating that it was at your special request.
When I read that, I was suddenly more frightened than I have ever been in my life. I got up to my feet,
Somehow, I climbed the stairs to the gallery, switched on the light, and about 6 yards in front of me, crawling along the floor, was a man's hand. My uncle's hand. It was like a hideous grey toad.
I don't believe it. I can't believe it. It doesn't make sense.
There, Saunders. Do you believe in all those books? It's throwing them down. Do you hear? It's throwing them down.
It's insane. The whole thing is insane.
If you mean that it's insane, I believe you're right. I told you it led me a devil's own dance the night before I trapped it. It can move like lightning, whatever it is. It was only by chance I forced it onto the shelf and jammed it in. I was exhausted and sickened by the whole business.
Well, it's got its strength back now, it seems. My God! Those were hurled at us.
At me? Now, we'll have to get up to the gallery to catch it. We must. Come on.
But how the devil can we catch it?
Don't know, but we must. That's all.
I still can't believe it.
I can't. It must be a rat
throwing books. It's there. It's behind there. Put your own hand in there. What are you waiting for? Feel it, feel, feel it, feel the smooth stump of it and those long fingers. Go on, feel
look,
it.
Sixtus, you must get a hold of yourself. It can't be a hand. It can't.
Where have you...
There.
Do you see? It's out.
Oh my God.
Oh. It's coming down the steps there. Saunders, we must get out of... We mustn't get out of this room.
It's trying to open the window.
We must head it off. Stand by the door so we can't get out.
Right. It's coming towards you, Eustace. It's on the piano.
It's horrible. It's horrible. It's as cold as death. I can't hold it. I can't. It's pointing through it in the fire. I can't do that. Saunders. Saunders, for heaven's sake, look on my desk. There is a hammer and some nails.
Oh, you can't mean...
Do exactly as I tell you. It's the lid of the box down there.
Yes.
I'm going to nail it to it. Yes. Yes. That's it. Now. Give me that hammer. Hold that nail above it. Damn it, then. Do what I say.
It's writhing. You're hurting it. There. Oh, Eustace, it's madness.
Now. Open the desk. You can stay in there till it dies. Whatever it is. If it can die. Now lock it. And the key goes in my pocket. Now, for the love of heaven, man. Brandy. More brandy.
Sir, I thought I'd let you know that I've done as you asked.
Done? Done what?
Well, sir, I found your note when I went into the library this morning. A draft must have blown it off the desk onto the floor.
What in the world are you talking about, Morton? I never wrote any notes.
Oh, excuse me, sir. I have it in my pocket. There it is, sir. It is undoubtedly your writing, Mr. Eustace.
My writing? Oh, give it to me. Give it to me quickly. Heaven's name, man. Do you think I could write this? Does it sound like me? Get a screwdriver, Morton, and break open the drawer of the old desk in the library. You need do nothing else. Do not open it. Only break the lock. Eustace Bolsover. Oh, why should I write to you about a thing like that while I'm in the same house as you, you stupid, stupid fool?
I'm sorry, sir. I'm most deeply sorry. I did think it odd. I thought when you didn't come down this morning, you'd left the note for me last night. It was on the floor, just beside your desk, sir. And it is like your writing, Mr. Eustace.
Yes, I grant you that. Oh, I'm sorry, Morton. You see, it can imitate handwriting. Look at that letter to old Stoker.
I beg your pardon, sir. Who can?
Nothing. No, it doesn't matter. Well, what happened? You did it, you say. You broke the law.
Yes, sir. First thing. I sincerely hope, sir.
No, Morton, because I can't blame you, but... Well, what are you staring at? Is there anything else?
Well, yes, sir. I'm afraid that one of your specimens from the laboratory must have got loose. A peculiar-looking creature. I saw it this morning in one of the corridors.
What colour was it?
Well, kind of greyish-white, sir. It crept along in a very funny way, sir. Most unusual.
Did anyone else see it?
Yes, sir. I'm afraid the maids did. They said it was... No, well, you'll excuse me, sir. They said it was a hand they saw. Emma trod on it once at the foot of the stairs. She thought it was a toad, only white. And then Jane was washing up the dishes in the scullery and she took her hands out of the water and was drying them absent-minded-like on the roller towel. And she found she was drying someone else's hand as well, only colder. Of course, I told them not to be silly. What's that?
I know. It must have squirmed off the nail somehow and found a pencil and paper in the drawer and pushed a note to Morton through
it's
the crack.
In the bathroom! Have you seen it? Why would you wash my hands?
I think it's mad. I've never seen anything more horrible.
We've got to get hold of it again. It's the only way. Which bathroom was it?
First floor, next to my room. Come on. Morton, yes, get a cloth of some kind and follow us. Anything, anything.
Yes, sir, yes.
Open the door carefully.
There. Look, there it is, in the bath.
It's slipped in somehow. It's trapped. It can't get out.
It keeps falling back. Oh, my God, look at it. That wound where you put the nail in is still gaping and bleeding. Does it feel pain, do you think?
I don't know. I don't know what it feels, and I don't care. I just want to get rid of it.
I had the most horrible dream about it. I dreamt I was putting on my gloves, those big fur ones, and it was inside one of them, even sleeping in it.
It's the length of its nails. They must have gone on growing up. Look at them. Where's Morton?
Morton! Hurry with that cloth!
Use a towel! This big bath towel!
This one is quick! It's on the blockchain. It's clogged. Oh, no, you brute, no. No, you filthy brute. You don't. I got it.
Hold it, Eustace! You must hold on to it!
I can't. It's all slippery. It's claws. It's scratching. It's trying to kill me. Shut the window!
I brought you a landing net from the laboratory, sir. I thought if it was an animal...
Damn, Morton, get out of the way!
It's gone out of the window, Morton, of all the idiotic times to come in.
Well, I really am sorry, sir. I honestly thought I was doing my best, sir. I did try to help. I do hope it wasn't one of your valuable animals, sir. I'm really very sorry. I'm very, very sorry.
Do you realise neither of us have shaved today? Normally, I look reasonably respectable in the mid-afternoon, even if I've been working in the lab. I look quite a stubble.
Yes, well, I find the prospect of going into my own bathroom after seeing it there this morning quite frightening.
Call me, if you need me. Now, where's Morton put my razor? Oh, here it is. What's it doing? Oh, my God. I can't bear it.
What happened? What's the matter?
It was here, waiting for me. I turned to pick up my razor, stretched out my hand, and suddenly there it was, grasping the handle of the razor and slashing for my throat. It tried to kill me. It wanted to kill me. It caught my neck here, see? When it realized it had failed, it dropped the razor and disappeared through the window. Why does it hate me? Why?
I told Morton we won't require him any more tonight and we should lock up very carefully.
Turn the key quickly. It mustn't get inside. Check the windows. Oh, what is it? That's what I can't understand. What is it?
No, I just don't know. Shouldn't we inform the authorities?
What will they say? The two fully grown men in full command of their faculties are
are terrified of an amputated hand. It hardly sounds convincing, does it?
It must have something to do with your uncle.
No, no. Adrian was a fine man. This thing is evil, dreadfully evil. It wants to kill me.
But he was blind. I suppose that made his hands more sensitive than most. Was he always blind?
Yes, as long as I remember. But no, it's useless to try that tactic. It wasn't my uncle. I think...
What?
Oh, I don't know. It's too fantastic. The whole thing is just too fantastic. Oh, what about a game of cards or chess or something? Oh, my nerve is going...
Look, have some brandy.
Yeah, yes. Yes, all right.
There, that should help.
Thank you. Thanks. Oh. Look, don't misunderstand me. I just want to say I am glad you're here with me. Not for your sake. I wish you weren't for your sake, but I don't think I could have borne this alone.
Look, I'm glad I can help. It's the least I can do. I mean, somehow we've both got to face this rationally. We're both sensible men. Now, suppose... Oh, no.
Suppose what? It doesn't matter how strange it seems. It couldn't be any stranger than what we've seen.
Well, it sounds ridiculous coming from me, of all people, but I suppose some folk might say that some kind of malignant spirit had got your uncle to prepare a tiny body for it, almost. That's the only thing.
But that is what I have been forced to think myself. And you remember what it said when I asked when I would see it. It said, when poor old Adrian's dead and I'm free. Well, it made itself free. It wrote that letter to the lawyer just before Adrian died. I mean, the instructions to have the body embalmed and the hand cut off and sent to me. But why? Why me?
You'd spoken to it. You were the contact.
No, it's more than that. I remembered something today, something my uncle said. I think he almost knew right at the end.
But you said he didn't know.
No, I don't mean fully. It was just at the end when he suddenly said, not apropos of anything particular, he suddenly said, education is good so long as you know to whom and for what purpose you give it. But with baser spirits... And then he drifted into a kind of doze. I waited for a little while and then I began to go out on tiptoe. And then he suddenly sat up and he said, before death, quite often people lose control of themselves and make absurd requests. And then he trailed off again and fell back. I didn't pay any real attention at the time. I wish to heaven I had.
Who's that? Oh. Who's there?
Me, sir. Morton.
Oh, thank heaven. Oh, I thought... Yes, all right. I'll unlock the door. You can come in, Morton. Oh, come in quickly so I can shut the door behind you.
Excuse me, Mr. Eustace. Something rather strange, sir. Huh? I was going the rounds to lock up and I found... this folded paper just inside the front door. I think it must have been slipped underneath, not through the letterbox. No. It's addressed to you.
Oh, give it to me, quickly. Quickly. Oh!
Will that be all, sir?
Oh, yes. Yes, Morton. You can go. Yes. Go and shut the door firmly.
Yes.
Firmly? Mr. Saunders will lock it behind you.
Yes.
Oh. Look. Look. It's from...
Yes. Yes, I know what it's from. Let me see. Ah, oh, yes. The old writing. Eustace, will 11 o'clock tonight be suitable for our last appointment?
Saunders, I can't bear it. I can't...
It's nothing. It's the ivy tapping. It's only the ivy.
It isn't. You know it isn't. But you can't get in. But thank heaven for that. At least the window is locked and the door...
It stopped. It's gone.
Oh, Saunders, why me? Why me? I'm no worse than other men. I've done nothing to be ashamed of. I am no worse than you, Saunders.
You spiked it through with that nail. I think it was filled with pure malevolence at first to everybody. Then you nailed it! It can get in.
What?
It can. We forgot. The chimney. There's no fire.
Oh. Quick, quick. Light the fire. Burn something. Anything. Burn it. Burn it.
Give me a match. Thank heaven the fire's ready.
It's no good. It'll never work quicker. Get off the hearth, brother. I'll block the chimney.
Well, where's the old reading lamp? There's oil in it. That'll get the fire going.
Now, hurry, man. Hurry. Come on.
Hurry. That's done it. Plenty of oil. It's blazing up.
Saunders, the hearth rug, the oil spilled on it. You don't need it now. Help me put it away. It's a light.
It's no good. It's blazing. Eustace, get back, man. Come on, get back. We must get out.
The whole place will go up. Saunders, get help. We'll never manage it. Unlock the door and get help.
Morton, fire.
It's here. My God. It's here. It's in the room. Help me, Saunders. Morton. Help me.
Rushing back into the blazing library, Saunders saw Eustace Bolsover spotlighted in a brilliant flash of light as the oil-drenched fireplace burst into flames. He saw Bolsover stumble and then fall to the floor. Then he caught a glimpse, or thought he did, of something black and charred creeping across the floor towards the terrified man. Then the smoke billowed up and swept the scene away. As the smoke cleared for a second, he saw the thing fastened hideously, grotesquely, around Eustace Bolsover's throat. Bolsover's eyes were turned towards him, pleading with Saunders to save his life. Then the flames engulfed him. In the morning, Saunders searched in the smouldering ruins for some sign of his friend. There was nothing. The bones had fused and limed in the intense heat. Of the hand, there was no trace. Saunders, you will realize now that Saunders is not his real name, has always been unwilling to interpret this horrible sequence of events. He has tried unsuccessfully to shut them from his mind. He once intimated to me that it could have been some malevolent ancestor of the Bolsovers that by some hereditary defect had managed to inhabit the flesh of his dead uncle. Or that it could have been the spirit of a former employee, a black-haired, spiteful little brute who died cursing Bolsover because he couldn't live to settle a score with him. On my last visit to see Saunders, he produced from between the pages of a Bible a blackened fragment of paper, part of the last short note sent by the creature. Will 11 o'clock be suitable for our... Showing it to me, Saunders crumpled forward, his face white and haggard. I can still hear that awful cry. The writing on the paper is thin and shaky, almost spidery. The writing of an old man or an old woman. And it is steeped in utter, indescribable evil. As I handed it back to Saunders, he whispered to me, "You see, I don't think the hand was destroyed. I believe it is still alive, waiting to strike again." Is he right? I don't know. All I do know is that everything you have heard is true. And I pray that none of you ever encounter the beast with five fingers. James Lawrenson was Eustace Bolsover, Kim Wall Saunders, and Cyril Luckham Morton. Our story was written by W.F. Harvey and dramatized for radio by John Kearcross. The director was Martin Jenkins. I am Edward de Souza, the man in black. And I shall be back next week with another story in my series, Fear on Four.